A motorized bicycle spark ignition system consists of a rotating magnet with one end as being north pole and the other end being south pole. A coil that picks up that magnetic force field and translates that into a sine wave voltage, which is what is represented here. That voltage goes to a CDI, which will trigger its output at a certain level of voltage on the negative going part of the sine wave, and it outputs a voltage spike to the ignition coil, which amplifies that to be 10,000 volts going to the spark plug, which produces a spark. The standard setup is a combination of the CDI and the high voltage coil in one. And the disadvantage to that is they limit the amount of electronics they use, so they have a very crude control of when the spark happens. And the high voltage coil is very limited in size, so the spark that's produced is of less strength. And the weaker the spark is, the slower the combustion. In this video, you can see that he's got timing marks set right here. I think that's TDC, 10, 20, 30. This is a tachometer, and it's showing about 1,000 RPM right now. You can see the static coil right here, and here's the rotating magnet. Here's the pointer. You can see it right now. Okay, this is 10. This is top dead center right here. So we've got right now about 17 degrees before top dead center. Okay, you'll see that increase as he increases the RPM, and I think it maxes out like at 33. Let's just watch as he increases the RPM. Okay, so what we just saw is a gradual increase of the degrees before top dead center as he increased the RPM, and he went all the way up to 8,000. And that's what generally is graphed right here on this graph, this purple graph right here. And that is typical of a four-stroke. So I think the Chinese factories, in their quest to keep the costs down as much as possible, just purchased the cheapest CDI they had available to them, which in this case has the timing curve of a four-stroke. These are the timing curves of a two-stroke, okay? The same as that, it increases as the RPMs increase, but then about halfway through, it starts to decrease. And that decrease, causing the spark event to happen closer to top dead center, enables the bike to have more power at high RPM. As far as the specifics of explaining exactly how that happens, I'm not going to get into that. I'll just take my word for it. It's real. Almost all two-stroke motorcycles have a timing curve like this. If they don't, they should. I want to show you an example of why it's important to be able to adjust the CDI. On the switch number two, there's three different positions, and I tried all four settings on my bike, and these are the details of my bike right here. And this graph shows the maximum RPM with the different settings. So obviously my bike likes switch setting number one, which is on this PC board. It's this right here. With any one of those set to the left position and the other two set to the right position, which is the left being on and the right being off. And on this board, it's these three right here. One of those being on to the right. This right here explains what changes you can make to your engine and in what direction the timing will need to be from ideal, if it was ideal previous to that. It has to do with compression, the squish band, the size of the carburetor, the type of exhaust pipe, the type of engine oil, and the ignition system, how strong the spark is. Very important, getting that timing just right. You can see how much of a difference it makes here. This right here is a horsepower graph, and you've got two graphs right here. And this graph right here, where he's able to keep the power up at high RPM, is when he retarded the spark timing by 4 degrees. So you can see on some engines it's very critical when that spark happens at the top RPM, which is why I advocate the performance CDI in place of the stock CDI. Because for one, you get a stronger spark from the ignition coil, and you have, in the case of the performance CDI that I originated, you have little switches on it that enable you to adjust when that spark happens. This is an old picture I have with the performance CDI in a larger box. And this is a ignition coil from a motocross bike. This is a video showing performance CDI in action. In this case, the spark gap was increased on the spark plug to show how good it is. You can see the large spark gap there. Again, you can see how excessive that is, just to show how strong the spark is. This is another video of mine, and I think this is top dead center. So real low RPM, you've got whatever that was, 17 degrees, and then it advanced with more RPM. Let me replay it for you. I mean, it starts with high RPM and then goes down. So what you'll see is that the magnet, let's say this is the magnet, you see the pointer on the magnet go to the left, which means it's advancing more. And then it goes back to the right as it goes back to low RPM. It starts at 10,000 RPM. That was a I think that's 10 degrees before top dead center. This is my website. It's got lots of good information. Copycat CDIs, and they're not adjustable, which is crazy, because if you want the best performance from your engine, you've got to be able to adjust for the modifications you do to the engine. You got to have a setting for standard, which is using a cylinder head without a squish band, low compression, no expansion chamber. And so as you make these modifications to your engine, you're able to adjust the timing with my CDI. This page shows the micro switches on the board. There's three micro switches right here, which mostly affect the high RPM timing. And there's two micro switches here, which mostly affect the low and mid RPM timing. You adjust these for the best response off idle, and you adjust these for the best top RPM speed. These are graphs showing the differences in the timing curves as you change those switches. So this is something I highly recommend. This is a comparison to the Lightning CDI. Also with high RPM engines, the stock RPM is like 6,000 maximum. I like to adjust mine by increasing the porting and using the expansion chamber to go up to like 8,000 or 9,000. Some people have taken them all the way up to 10,000. If you replace the cylinder with a motorcycle cylinder, you can go all the way up to 12,000. So at high RPM, there's an advantage in changing the stock stator coil, which is a three-wire coil, because it has additional windings for the 12-volt lighting. And so if you get a coil that only has two wires coming out of it, that means it's without that lighting coil, and it has more, it can have more windings for the regular stator coil, which means you're going to have a higher voltage out here, which means a higher voltage going to the spark plug. And generally speaking, the stock coil is not very good, and it fails pretty often. But a lot of failures are because people don't realize that the ground path from the shell of the spark plug goes through the cylinder, through the cases, through the screws, to this metal frame right here, or in some cases to one of these wires here. It goes to a terminal ending on the screw. So all these contact points where metal touches metal have to be clean. And some of these new stator coils have varnish on this metal that needs to be scraped clean. That's one of many tips you have to understand about these engines. Those contact points are the ground path for this system, because voltage works in a loop. Okay, I guess that's all I have to say on the subject. If you want the best performance, you want the best reliability. I say reliability because with two advanced and ignition, you get too high of a combustion pressure at top dead center, and that's all that pressure is on the bearings, on the conrod bearings and on the crankshaft bearings, and it wears them out prematurely. So you get more reliability, more power, also less vibration, because this premature combustion pressure can be felt in engine vibration. So it's just such a win-win situation when you replace the stock CDI. Highly recommended. Highly recommended. Okay, thanks for watching.